Our call to worship comes from Psalm 30, and I'm reading the first four verses. I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord my God, I called to you for help, and you healed me. You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing the praises of the Lord, you his faithful people, praise his holy name. The psalmist says we must praise the Lord in song, and we must praise the Lord at all times. So let us do just that as we praise the Lord in song, as we sing that wonderful hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long, praising my Savior all the day long.
Our first lesson comes from the Gospel of John, and I'm reading from chapter 21, and I'm reading the first 19 verses. I know it's a long reading, but please, it's a wonderful text to read. Verse 1. Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not recognize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciples whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he was had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 meters. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish you have caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, but even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said, this is to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Because Christ is risen, because he conquered death, and because we believe in him as our Lord and Savior, he has resurrected us as well. So our lives are in him. Let us join together in singing that wonderful song, my life is in you, Lord.
Is it?
Please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. O dear Lord God and Heavenly Father, O Lord, we come before you with singing, rejoicing, Lord, this morning as we celebrate once again the resurrection of our risen Lord, your Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord, truly what a celebration it is to know that your Son conquered death. Our Lord conquered sin so that we may be set free and that he could take control over all things, both good and bad. O Lord, how can we ever thank you for what you have done for us by giving us and showing us that unconditional love that no one can surpass, that your Son, our Lord, Jesus, was willing to sacrifice his life for each and every one of us. O Lord, as we approach your eternal throne today, we just pray, Lord, that you will hold us very tightly during our service, that you will embrace us with your love, and that you will just bring a peace and a calm upon us, so that truly we may be blessed by your touch upon repentant hearts today. O Lord, we pray, just be with us. And as we come now, Lord, we would like to repent. We would like to say that we are sorry and ask for your forgiveness for all the things we've done wrong. So, Lord, we pray in our silence now that you hear our personal and individual confessions. O dear Lord God, truly what a wonderful joy to know that once we've repented, you forgive us, Lord, and you have promised us that we know that your promises are true and that we can trust them. O Lord, we thank you and we praise you that we are able to come to you in the name of Jesus and ask for atonement. So, Lord, we pray, be with us now. Touch each and every one of us. Bless our gathering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our second lesson comes from the book of the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, and I'm reading the first 9 verses. Hear the word of God. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anything. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. I only read thus far. May the Lord bless his holy word to us today. As we await God's message, let us ask him to draw us close to him, that he may embrace us, that we may really feel his presence. As we join together in prayerfully singing, "Draw Me Close to You."
Never let lay it all down again, to hear you say that I'm afraid. You are my desire, no one else will do, 'cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way, bring me back to you.
As we prepare ourselves for the message from God, let us just ask Him to grant us the wisdom to understand what it is He wants to say to us. So let us pray. Oh dear Lord Jesus, as we have gathered, yeah, Lord, to hear Your word to us, we just want to pray, dear Lord God, that You will give us the wisdom to understand Your scriptures, to understand the message, Lord, so that truly we may hear You today. Oh Lord, we also ask that You will touch our hearts and our minds, and that You will make us receptive to those, that not only will we receive Your word, but that we will put it into practice in our lives. Oh yes, dear Lord God, and as I bring Your message to these Your people, I pray, Lord, that You will use me, and that all the words and the meditations that flow from my lips will be Your words and meditations, Lord, and that they will bring You only honor and glory at all times. So, Lord, we pray, meet with us now, speak to us, and teach us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Folks, this morning, I want to speak to you about something. Many a time I speak to people about our Lord Jesus Christ, how wonderful he is and how good he is and what he has done for us. And I ask people to respond to his wonderful love and to his touch and just be with him. And many a time I get an answer that has become very, can I say, stereotypical of people. People keep saying to me, you know, John, I'm not good enough to be a child of God. And I still have to sort out my life. And one day when I've done that, I will come. Other people would say to me, John, I'm not ready. You know, I feel I'm still in the world and I cannot come because I'm not worthy of being a Christian. Others would come with all types of excuses in the world in not coming to church or not coming to Jesus Christ. To me, there's a big difference in coming to church and coming to Jesus Christ. Coming to Jesus Christ means giving your heart to him and really following him and just basking in the wonderful love that he has for each and every one of us. Now, when people say they are not good enough, or they say to me, John, I'm a very bad person. I have sinned so much. I have all these habits and I have all these things that I do. I just sit and wonder if we really are listening to ourselves. The past couple of weeks, I've been talking to you on what Jesus has done for us and how he wants us to come and work for him and to spread his gospel to the world. But I want to say to you that there is no such thing. That I'm not good enough. Or I'm a bad person. Because Paul says to us that we all have sinned. And we fall short of the glory of God. So what I want to say to you is that everybody who is a Christian is not better than what you are. We are all sinners. We have all committed sin. We all continually commit sin. And I think in a worldly term, we can be bad people. But we've met the Lord Jesus Christ. And we've taken him to his promise. Of what he has said to us. Because remember, Jesus said, I have not come for the righteous, I have come for the sinner. You see, if you are righteous, you don't need Jesus. Because then you are whole. And your relationship with God is good. But if you are a sinner, that is when you need Jesus. A lot of people make the problem. They say, oh, I'm a very good person. I don't need Jesus. You know, I give a lot to charity and I give a lot to people and I care for a lot of people. And yes, that's wonderful. It's great. And it's part of being Christian. But we all do need Jesus. You see, because it is Jesus that died upon the cross. It is Jesus that went into the depths of the earth and took control of death, took control of sin, and he is the one that has authority over death and sin. So you see, folks, if we don't believe in Jesus Christ and we don't offer our lives to Jesus Christ, our hearts to Jesus Christ, where are we going? Because it is only Him that has conquered death. It is only Him that has conquered sin. And if we don't believe in Jesus Christ, we are lost. But I want to refer this morning to the text we read. Wow, and I want to ask you, where do you want a greater bad person or sinner or a person not worthy than Saul, eventually named Paul? Now, you may say to me, John, how can you say he's a bad person? Well, let me tell you something. I think he did something that you don't even dream of doing. He persecuted all the followers of Jesus Christ. We saw how Paul gave the order for Stephen, one of the followers of Jesus, to be stoned. Yes. And what happened? Just before Stephen's death, Stephen saw Jesus. And he said, I see the Lord Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father. So it's on Paul. He gave the command for Stephen to be stoned. And in the text today, he even goes to the chief priest. We don't know whether it's Annas or Caiaphas, but he goes to the chief priest, who is a Sadducee. And he goes to him and he says to him, I want a letter because I'm on my way to Damascus. And if I find anybody who is or follows the way of Jesus Christ, be it a man or a woman, I want to arrest them and take them to Jerusalem, where ultimately they will be executed. Folks, do you realize how bad Paul was? He refused to listen to Jesus Christ. He even refused to entertain speaking about Jesus Christ. Now, remember what I spoke about last week was when Peter was summoned before the Sanhedrin, Peter and all the disciples, where they were given an order not to do the teachings of Jesus. Here we have Paul, that if you dared do the teachings of Jesus Christ, he would execute you. He had that authority to execute you. So you see, how bad can the thing be that you've done that makes you not worthy of coming to Jesus Christ? I want to say to you, no matter what your sin is, no matter what you've done, there's nothing that can be worse than what Paul did. Paul is not only a murderer, he is a blasphemer. He kills the people who follow Jesus Christ. Have you ever done that? No, of course not. Have you ever executed somebody that follows Jesus Christ? Johnny, you're mad. I've never killed anybody in my life, and I'm not a murderer. Well, I want to tell you that Paul was a murderer, and he did this to all those who did this to Jesus Christ. Now, today, I want to teach you a new word. A new word that you can remember, and oh, it sounds very fancy. Now, remember, I'm not trying to be fancy, but this is what theologians refer to. And that is a Christophany. A Christophany. Do you know what a Christophany is? Remember, I told you about an epiphany, and that is a revelation. And then you have a theophany, where God was shown or appeared to people. And today, yes, of course, you've guessed it. A Christophany is where Jesus appears to somebody, Jesus Christ. That is known as a Christophany. Now, This can happen in many ways, and in the way it happens to Paul is a very, very dramatic way. He appears to Paul in the form of a very bright light. It flashed to him from heaven. So this is Jesus appearing to Paul from heaven. And as Paul is thrown from his donkey and he lays on the ground, Jesus speaks to him. Now, there's a great big difference here if you look at what happened to the disciples, where Jesus appears to them that they can see him. Yeah, Paul can't see Jesus, but he appears to Jesus in a bright light. You see the difference? And when he falls, Jesus asks him, he says, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Now we must remember, yeah, why does Jesus say that? Why do you persecute me? It's because Paul is persecuting those that are teaching the way of Jesus Christ. So when you persecute a follower of Jesus Christ, whether you agree with them or not, you are actually persecuting Jesus. Wow. Have we ever thought of the implication of that? It is quite a rough one. Because I'm sure there's somebody in the church that you do not like. Because of the ways they go about things, the way they do things. But yet, they're in church seeking Jesus Christ. Seeking the way that Christ meets with them, in the way they can serve him. And this is all they're seeking. And in their mannerisms, in the ways they do this, we might not like it. And therefore, we don't like them. And we don't want anything to do with them. So I think there are a few people that don't like certain people in the church or in the Christian organization. And yet, if we are doing that, because as soon as we distantiate ourselves from one another, we are doing the direct opposite of what Jesus intended. What did Jesus say? Is we must love one another. We must love one another. We must take care of one another. And we must serve one another. Oops. So when you avoid people that are serving Jesus Christ, yes, you've got it. You're persecuting Jesus. Because we are going against what Jesus wants us to do. You ever thought of it that way? Because that's exactly what Jesus says to Saul. Why do you persecute me? He never touched Jesus, but he killed everybody that tried to follow Jesus. So if I don't like somebody or I don't love somebody, I am persecuting Jesus. These people, and remember now I'm talking about Christians. If I don't love a fellow Christian, I am persecuting Jesus. So John, what do I do when these people have these ways in doing things? You know what? You love them for who they are and for what they are. Now, remember many a time I've said to you, when you look at people, look at them through the eyes of Jesus. Because as soon as you look at them through the eyes of Jesus, you will not see them in the way you think is right, but rather you will see them with unconditional love. Whether they're doing the right things or whether they're doing the wrong things, in your opinion, Jesus is working with them. They are God's people. You know, my supervisor, and I know I've mentioned this very many times, but my supervisor, Dr. Eddie Germacay, has very often said to me, John, if there's somebody giving you a hard time in church, do not lash out at them. Do not avoid them. Because remember, they are still God's people. You are God's representative. And you are working with God's people. And he calls us to love them. So this morning I want to say to you folks, don't persecute Jesus by not loving others. Because what happens when you persecute Jesus? That means you cannot be in a relationship with somebody that you persecute. There is no way you can persecute somebody and love somebody. But the wonderful thing is, and I want us to just think of this a little bit, yet Jesus asks Saul, why do you persecute me? Saul asks and he responds and he says, who are you, Lord? And he says, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now Jesus then says to him, now get up and go into the city and you will be told what to do. Now, you see what Jesus does here. Although Paul was persecuting Jesus, Jesus doesn't reject him. No, he doesn't. Actually picks him up and he tells him, he says, go into the city and I will tell you what to do. It's exactly the same as what he does with Peter. Peter denies him three times. And what does Jesus do? He doesn't turn his back on Peter. No, he doesn't. Yeah, in the passage we have today out of John's gospel, three times. You know, he was denied three times. Yet again, three times he asks Peter. He says, Peter, do you love me? Peter says, yes, of course, Lord. He says, well, then love my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Of course you know I love you, Lord. And three times. And in the scriptures, Jesus builds his church on Peter. And we know that for 3 days, Paul or Saul could not see a thing because Jesus had blinded him. He was in darkness, just like Jesus. When Jesus died and he went into hell, he was in darkness. Yet too, Paul was in darkness. But what happens? Paul has a change of heart. Because he sees that Jesus is real. He sees that Jesus cares. And as soon as Jesus gives him his sight back, what happens? Paul becomes one of the way. Those he wanted to persecute. And 2/3 of the New Testament is written by Paul. That is how he committed his life to Jesus Christ. You see, it is Jesus that brought the healing. It is Jesus that brought the forgiveness. And it is Jesus who made Paul's heart whole again. In the exact same way he made Peter's heart whole. And so too, the Lord Jesus wants to heal your heart. He wants your heart and he wants to make you without blemish. Don't come and say, oh, John, but I've sinned too much. No, Jesus justifies you as if you've never, never, ever committed that sin. So I ask you today, are you persecuting Jesus? Are you rejecting Jesus just like Paul did or just like Peter did? There is hope for you. Turn and follow Jesus. That is the invitation to you this morning. I can't answer that for you. Only you can. And if you need help, you are most welcome to call me, come and see me. If you're far away from me, a telephone call is not far away. I will always be willing to talk to you and to help you. The invitation is there. Use it and make your heart whole once again. Amen. Come, let us pray. Oh, dear Lord God, we've heard your word to us today, Lord. And yes, Lord, there is still so much that we need to learn about you and learn what it is you want us to do. Oh, Lord, we thank you for speaking to us today. We thank you, Lord, for teaching us. And yes, Lord, how mistaken we've been. Oh, Lord, help us with this thing of grudges. Help us with this thing that we have, Lord, when we hold it against other people and when we don't like other people. Yes, Lord, help us to be different. Help us to exhibit you in our lives. Oh, Lord, help us to not persecute you. Help us to do exactly what it is you want us to do. Oh, Lord, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity. We thank you that it is you that teaches us. It is you that leads us. It is you that takes an interest in us. Oh, Lord, help us to be your servants. Help us to be what you want us to be, so that truly we may know that it is you that we serve. So, Lord, we thank you today, and we praise you in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service today in joining together in singing that wonderful song, one of my personal favorites, I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. Let's join together in singing. Folks, receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us here now today and forevermore. Amen. And may God bless each and every one of you with His richest blessing until we meet again. Folks, have a wonderful week. Thank you for listening today. Thank you that you allowed me into wherever you may be. Have a wonderful week and may God bless you. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.